It's another golden year, and joining us today, I'm delighted to say, Nik Kershaw. Hello.
Hi, Ken. How are you?
Great. How are you?
Very well. Thank you very much. Good.
Busy old time coming up for you, isn't it?
Yep. Yep. It's my own silly fault.
Because you're embarking on a tour to celebrate 40 years.
Yep.
That's the first remarkable thing. It's 40 years.
Yeah.
Since you are sort of Annus Mirabilis of 1984.
Yes.
And it was all working then, wasn't it? Everything just came together.
It was pretty much everything I touched, yeah, turned to gold. It was an astonishing year for me. So it seemed, you know, 40 years later, it seemed rude not to celebrate it some way. Yeah. And there were two albums in 1984, and we'd be playing both.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. You're going out on tour, and you're doing a long show each night. You know, you're not having a support act on before you, and you're doing one album, but you're doing both sets.
Exactly. So if you buy a ticket, I'm all you get.
I wouldn't put it quite like that. You get a double portion.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's going to be a bit of a slog for you every night, isn't it?
People say, oh, touring, it must be so tiring, you know, and it really isn't. It's just a myth put out by people that want you to think that. It's kind of, it can be quite boring, but, you know, you're only working a couple of hours a day, and the rest is hanging around.
People do. They complain about being in strange cities in odd hotels and you know, but being lonely in many cases.
Well, yeah, I've got my lovely band with me, so and they've been with me for a while, and we all get on terribly well.
So you're taking this right round the country. I can see some of the places, London obviously, but places like Bath, Portsmouth, New Brighton, Lincoln, Sunderland, wanting to get out to the people everywhere.
Yes, I think so. And then after that, we're off to Europe for a couple of weeks. So I'm just looking forward to all the shows. It's going to be great.
Over the years, you've been involved in writing and producing with lots of other people, just so many other people. Is there, you know, sort of constant questing in you to find something new to do, something different to do?
I get bored very easily, yeah. I've got a very, small attention span. But I spent most of the 90s, writing with or producing with other people, which is incredible. It's a great time. I've learned a huge amount, met some lovely people, but ultimately, I'm the control freak in me took over, and I started making my own records again at the end of the 90s.
Looking back to the 80s, you know, when this show is all built around, it must have swept you off your feet, really, what was going on, because everything was such a whirlwind.
It really was. I mean, beginning of January 1984, I couldn't get arrested, and end of January 1984, I couldn't go out in public without getting jumped on. So yeah, it literally happened that quick.
You coped?
I coped. Yeah, I moaned a bit at the time, because it's just an incredible life change very quickly, and it was quite bewildering and quite, you know, there were a few stressful moments, but ultimately I was living my dream.
And the dream will be relived in this tour, the 1984 tour, which is happening very, very soon. We've asked you to choose a golden year. You've not chosen that year, but you've gone back really early in your life to 1972. So tell me what you were doing in 1972.
Well, these are my formative years, you know, sort of early 70s, when I was discovering music, really. So I was at school. I would have been 14 years old. And just soaking everything up, really. I mean, my parents were quite musical, so it was around all the time, but it was their music, and it was kind of, I didn't really take my own interest until I kind of got into my early teens.
Right, yeah, because as you say, your mother and father were both very musical. Opera was part of the world, wasn't it?
My mum trained as an opera singer. So there was that, and my dad played the flute in the local orchestra. So it was, basically classical, along with one Simon and Garfunkel album they possessed.
So were you a bit of a rebel in musical terms?
I don't think they had any particular vision for me at all. They just wanted me to get on. You know, my brother paved the way, because he went to university and then flunked out to become a dolphin trainer. So they were quite ready for me to do whatever I wanted to do, really.
Do you think music does pass down in the genes? Does it pass from generation to generation?
I think any talent you have must do, yeah. You know, I've got accountants. My accountant's an accountant's son, who's an accountant's son, and it goes like that, doesn't it? I mean, I'm sure the genes are very much responsible for whatever talents we have.
But when you're a musician's son, you don't have to escape too far, do you? You don't have to go too far to enjoy yourself.
No, absolutely, you really don't.
You know, you don't have to go into accountancy, for instance, would you?
No, that was never an option for me.
Right, let's look at the songs you've chosen. So, Alice Cooper, first of all, School's Out.
Right, well, so I'm sitting there watching Top of the Pops, and this bloke turns up, bizarrely singing about what I've just done. I'd broken up for school for the summer holidays. Anyone would think it was a cynical marketing ploy by Warner Brothers, but and there was this fellow who looked very scary, and I thought, my parents are going to hate him. That's brilliant. So I loved the song. It's very immediate. I went and bought an album called Killer, which he had out at the time. That was a big album. And then there was an album later on in the year called Billion Dollar Babies. On my wall, I had sort of pictures of the 1970 FA Cup winning Chelsea side, and the picture of Slade, I think, and then this massive picture of Alice on stage, which Mum was very worried.
Alice Cooper turned out to be a golf-playing middle-class gentleman.
I know, a very good golf player, apparently, and born-again Christian, so who knew?
You can't go by appearances.
You can't.
There's Alice Cooper, School's Out, and here again is Nik Kershaw choosing songs from 1972. So were you performing music by that age?
Not only in a mate's front room. Yeah, he pretended to be Mark Bolan, I pretended to be David Bowie on a Sunday afternoon at his house. He had a guitar and I wanted one, but no, I wasn't in any shape to perform to anybody. I don't think that didn't come until a couple of years later.
What gave you the enthusiasm to go into genuine professional performance and not just hang around and playing in the front room?
I think it's just a kind of a need to be the centre of attention, Ken. I think it's basically what it comes down to, because before that I just wanted to be an amazing something. I wanted to be a famous racing driver or a famous footballer or a famous actor or something. I think the famous thing was quite attractive to me. I don't know why, because I could live this very normal sort of middle class existence on the outskirts of Ipswich, but I just felt that, you know, I guess lots of kids of that age think there's a calling somewhere. I felt called.
Well, the call was genuine. It was for you, and you answered. Let's hear another song you've chosen, Argent, and Hold Your Head Up.
At this time, I'd be, you know, on a Sunday evening, I'd be sitting upstairs with my reel-to-reel tape recorder taping Alan Freeman and Pick of the Pops. And it went right way down. I think it started at the top 100 and he picked out various records at the time. I remember this one coming on, I think, and this is, what's this? You know, because basically it's prog, you know, and I hadn't heard prog before. I didn't know what this was. So I was completely intrigued by it. And I remember, you know, taping it and, you know, trying to catch it so you didn't get Alan Freeman. You just got Argent. And it was also one of the first gigs I ever saw was at Ipswich Civic College. They played there, and my abiding memory is a part of the PA nearly falling on Rod Argent, which is unfortunate. But I met Rod a few years later. I judged the Ivor Novello Awards with him. What a lovely man.
Highly talented man.
Yeah, yeah. Amazing.
And a great band.
And Russ Ballard, obviously, from that group, who went on to write some amazing songs.
There's Argent and Hold Your Head Up. Nik Kershaw is choosing his favourite songs from a golden year of his, 1972. We have a Cat Stevens and the famous recording of Morning Has Broken.
We do, famous indeed. It was probably number one for 5 or 6 weeks or something. It's a long time. Every time you switch the telly on or the radio on, it was there. You couldn't escape it. But I live in Dulcis, Suffolk, as does Rick Wakeman, and Rick played the piano on this, and he's a great storyteller, as you probably know, Ken. And I was at a garden party recently, and he was the guest at this garden party, and he tells this great story about the fact that Morning Has Broken is a hymn, right? Yeah. It was just like but there's only three verses, and they were recording it, went through it, and it was about 50 seconds, the whole song. So the producer said, well, can we pad it out a bit? So he got this intro together, and that was like a minute and a half, but he just kept adding to it, and the whole arrangement. I think he ended up sort of basically been responsible for about 2/3 of the actual song, and he got paid £8 for it.
Has he spent it yet? That's the question.
I think he possibly has.
Morning Has Broken, Cat Stevens singing, and Rick Wakeman playing piano. 1972 is the golden year for Nik Kershaw, who's now thinking of David Bowie and Starman.
To be fair, I didn't really discover Bowie until 73. I was it's kind of the Aladdin insane period, and then I kind of went back and rediscovered Ziggy Stardust and Hunky Dory and Space Oddity and all that stuff. So that's the period I was totally into Bowie. And he, like a lot of my peers, is responsible for me not having a proper job, really. I just saw him on a documentary, a nationwide documentary. And I thought, that's what I want to do. But this song in particular, I don't think I was aware of it at the time, but there's an iconic Top of the Pops performance with him and Mick Ronson standing on his shoulder singing the choruses down a microphone. And I love Bowie, and I have been known to perform this song live myself.
Let's have the original, though, just,
yeah, why not?
Just for today. David Bowie, Starman, and Nik Kershaw is on to his final choice of 1972, which is Lindisfarne.
As we've discovered, I was getting into music and picking up instruments and just trying to, you know, pick a tune from them. And I a friend had a bass guitar, and I was struggling with the sixth string. I thought, well, you know, about one note at a time. How difficult can that be? and this was the first bass line I ever learned, and I was so proud of myself. In fact, the bass line to me is more familiar than the actual tune of the song. But again, this is another one of my early gigs. I remember seeing Lindisfarne at St Matthew's Baths in Ipswich. But I think I remember rightly, this was an encore, and I had to be home by 10 o'clock, so I think I missed it.
Oh, God, that's dreadful. Oh, well, we'd be happy to make up for that and play it for you.
Thank you very much.
Apologies to any bass players who are listening. No offence. He didn't really mean it. 1984, the tour, we wish you huge success with that, and we know it will be. Everybody will want to hear those songs again and again. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Ken.